you know, this is absolutely amazing. You can just feel the energy of possibility in this room. It's such an incredible and dynamic time as I watch and think about all of you moving forward with the capacity to heal, so mission-driven and ready to go. And really, you're stepping out at one of the most dynamic times imaginable in healthcare. The Robert Wood Johnson Foundation has tried to coin a phrase to say that it's time that we turn in this country to a culture of health, to a culture of healing. And in order for us to really move to this culture, we really have to envision that every person in our diverse society should have the right to be as healthy as possible. And to have full health, it means you have to have access to healthcare. And you have to ensure that healthcare is not a luxury for some and an impossibility for others. And to make that reality, this culture of health, come to life, we all must galvanize the profession to be more courageous and step forward fully in leadership roles in the House of Medicine. And as we do this, we have to recognize that osteopathic medicine, too, is also at a tipping point. It's at this possibility where we have the ability to positively influence today's healthcare system. We're building on our growth. We are moving forward and responding to the increasing demands by patients for patient-centered care and osteopathic philosophies of care. We're providing solutions to team-based care and even realigning graduate medical education pathways. These are indeed dynamic times. And these are the times that will require you to not only utilize your talents and skills as physicians, but also to have the courage to lead. When I reflect on what it means to have courage to lead, I think about people like Harriet Tubman, who walked back in 1850s from Maryland through Delaware, through Pennsylvania, through New York, to upstate New York, to the borders of Canada for her freedom, moving only at night, walking in rain, snow, sleet, and hail, and found herself at points of freedom, only to turn and say, I have to go back. I have to help others. And so 2 months after doing that, she went back and freed 11 more slaves. And then she came back and did it again and again and again and again. 12 times this woman walked back and brought forward over 100 slaves to freedom. That is courage to lead. But you too also stand on the foundation of other courageous, courageous leaders. A.T. Still himself had the courage to lead when he stepped out and said, there needs to be a new philosophy of medicine. And he opened the American School of Osteopathy, which is now A.T. Still University. And he took upon the idea that osteopathic medicine must promote for physicians the importance of focusing on the disease, not symptoms, and created the concept of wellness and preventive medicine. But many also don't realize that A.T. Still was actually one of the biggest leaders in the abolitionist movement. And he had the unimaginable idea to start a medical school that said men and women will be admitted equally. The courage to lead. But let's think about it even in a more recent time. This month, right now, we actually are celebrating the 50th anniversary of the Medicare and Medicaid Act that was signed in 1965 by Lyndon B. Johnson. This was at a time that for 20 years, This bill came up and fell and up and fell over and over again. And the Congress finally had the courage to say only 50% of the people over 65 years of age have insurance. We must do something. And they created the Medicare and Medicaid Act. And then they even inserted into the 1965 bill a Civil Rights Act that said, and we will eliminate discrimination by race of patients and physicians. So you cannot, hospitals may not turn the door away for people based on race. And that unbelievable legislation, which now is responsible for over 112 million people being covered by insurance in this country today, and truly ensuring access to healthcare and to hospital facilities for people of any race, it was 1 year later after signing that bill that 60% of the Congress was voted out of office because of signing the Medicare and Medicaid Act. Courage to lead. Not leading where people want to go, but leading where people need to go. And even recently, some of you may have been at a celebration we call DO Day on the Hill, and we welcome students from across the country to go get ready to march on the Hill. And we took a moment to have students be able to ask questions, and one of the students asked about the transition of the AOA accredited residency programs to ACGME. And they said, how do you know this is the right time? How do you know that we will be okay? And it reminded me of my experience, and I said, there is a time for everything, and you just have to lead. And it took me back when I, in 1978, was admitted into the first class of women at Amherst College. At that point in time, liberal arts colleges up and down the New England coast were all male. And the alumni wrote me when I got my admissions letter. The very next day, I got a letter from two alums that said, I am sure you are a bright and intelligent woman with a great future in front of you, but please give us a call so we can help you get into a women's college. Well, needless to say, I didn't take their advice. But the beauty is 4 years later, 50% of the class, 50% of the college was women, and 50% were men. And it's hard to even remember a day, but you have to step forward with courage to lead. And so it is your time. It is your time now to grab that courage to lead. And as you move forward and think about your impact as a physician leader, I believe your efforts will be greatly enhanced if you remember four things. Remember, do not limit your role to that of a physician. Allow your responsibilities to go beyond the exam room. Think about the fact that you have been trained as an osteopathic medicine physician, and you have the ability to be a contributor to the evolution for better health for all. Enhance your role and opportunities throughout your career. Step up and serve. Seek opportunities on boards and in policy councils and public policy legislation. Serve as faculty. Be on community boards. Be in organizations throughout your community, state, and within federal activities, as well as internationally. Do not go silent. You've learned in a way and have a perspective that must be shared. Take that responsibility seriously. Secondly, I advise you that you have to remember that you are stronger together than you are alone. You are a force to be reckoned with. Osteopathic medicine is now a profession in numbers. Many of you may not be aware that osteopathic medicine is the fastest growing profession, healthcare profession in the US today. We are at a point that over the last 25 years, we have seen a 300% growth of osteopathic physicians in the US. And today, over 25% of all medical students in this country are training in osteopathic colleges like Ohio University. It's a time. You are a force to be reckoned with. Your journey is now, and your opportunities, because you have the numbers, is to use that to help make healthcare better in this country and in the world. But please remember this as well. Balance your life. Pace yourselves. Like your journey through education, your professional journey is a marathon, not a sprint. And as such, you have to remember that medicine requires resilience and adaptability because it is constantly evolving. It is constantly changing. There is never a moment where you'll say, I got this. But also, I can tell you this as a healthcare executive, but I can also tell you this as the wife of an emergency medicine physician and as the daughter of a physician. Take the time to refresh. Find joy in, yes, your job, but fulfill your life with joy in other areas in order to sustain you. It is essential, and in order to keep your passion. And finally, have the audacity to engage. Engage. We are in a world of technology where dating, my daughter's concept of dating, is to talk to somebody by texting. That isn't going to do it. It's time to engage. And you, as being trained in osteopathic medicine, have been given a gift. And together, we can help to teach the world what it feels like to engage. Engage with your patients, your children, your neighbors, their families. Get together, hear them out in the way that you've been taught, touch them, encourage them, but also together you will find the solutions. I remember to this day my father in the hospital, right before he passed of colorectal cancer, and I was fairly young. And we were around his bed, and there were three physicians and two residents, and my brother and I. And we sat there, and my father took my hand in his closed eyes, and he started to whisper. And he came and found a strength within as the physicians were talking. And he said, talk to me. The only person who knows how I feel and what's important to me is me. You have been gifted to understand empathy and the importance of engagement. Please have the audacity to engage. So it is your time. It is your time. Class of 2015, it is your time to lead in osteopathic medicine, in healthcare, and in improving health status worldwide. Trust that you are prepared. Do not limit your roles. Use your collective voice. Keep balance in your life. Have the audacity to engage, and have the courage to lead. I hold on to the words of Nelson Mandela, the quotes in my office, it's in my home. It's, there is no passion to a life playing small, to settling for a life that is less than the one you are capable of living. Do you have the courage to lead? Ohio University Heritage College of Osteopathic Medicine, class of 2015, I know you do. And I thank you for the difference you will make. Thank you all.